of the interest that I opened in the region, specific projects, but some more kind of numbers would be. And so I thought, presenting how academic work can help guide management advice. And so, management is about managing fisheries in a sustainable manner. For that, the advice that managers receive has to be based on this. I mean, data and methods. Traditionally, has been done on a single species basis, but sure, you know that for sure, quickly. Social and economic costs. And so for the past 2 decades, there's been a big push towards ecosystem based management, cross-conceptually, and now in a lot of countries making progress, expanding the implementation phase of ecosystem based management. Some have been more advanced than others. So this is a figure I borrowed from Brett's paper. So, management is an adaptive approach that aims at managing different objectives, economic objectives, social objectives, cultural objectives. And this figure is supposed to represent how different methods perform with respect to those different objectives. Importantly, it takes into account the knowledge and the uncertainties that we have on biotic and abiotic components, and also considers the human components of the ecosystem. And for the past decade or so, the highest priority for the open science has been to provide scientific support for ecosystem management. And when this is point A, there was a lot of people scratching their heads how I'm going to do this. Because even though it's the highest priority, managers still want to see every year we can fish this much carp or caper, whatever the kind of fish it is. And so, between what the scientific community was saying and what the managers need, and so how can we make it manageable? How can we provide advice for the system? Because I wanted to show you what we did and people are still doing. This is the focus on others, that's New Zealand, North Dakota. The political system that we were concerned with is the New Zealand level shelf. It's divided into divisions, and geographically, as we listen to trade, retail, and media. It has a lot of influence from the Arctic, it's a low Arctic system, and structurally, it has structure of a west-west. That means that the energy that's produced in the lower part of the food web, and here, it's funneled to the west between a handful of species. In New Zealand, it's basically bigger, and because that means the most important is bigger. And so, it's a key component. The system has sustainable fisheries for over 500 years since the times of John Cabot. And so it has a lot of importance, not just in the system. So, what I'm showing you there are some speech from the 1800s on top of the Atlantic Park, Northern Park, Pacific Park. And the bottom is Hartsfield. Actually, in England, if you say fish, it means park. The Hartsfields are very important socially. There's a hunt every year in the spring, early in the spring. And so it's a time where the weather's quite hot, so a lot of people spend a lot of time indoors and not fishing. child for about 10 seconds. It starts in the mid-80s. So we make beans and then we grind beans. These were the inputs to the fishing and it has been a bit better. In the last few years, it has increased a bit, but it has been fully recovered. The beans, another important component, taken in 1991, also collapsed. It decreased another magnitude from 1 year to the next. It was one of the switch. And for the past 20 years, also, hotfish. Hotfish are the most abundant animal in the northern hemisphere. And at the time that the Gulf was collapsing, the hotfish were in this ocean. Somewhere around this time, restrictions were put up. So the population was historically low, and when the restrictions were put in place, that reduced the population of certain different species. And for the last decade or so, it has been stable around 400,000. But when you see that particular plot, there's a lot of fingers and pointing. So, things are not. Maybe the problem for us was first seals. And so, what we did was we took what we thought were the most important components of our system, called hotfish, taken with fisheries, and also we assessed what happened when we did the interaction, we were talking about this work, and what relative role had the fisheries, hotfish, and taken on the last and not the recovery. And we found, so this is the main message, that the dynamics of plot were driven by a balance between the fisheries and the fertility. And the hotfish were not involved. So the dots there are the survey biomass of plot. And the red line is a biometric parametric model that will model the rate of change of plot as a function of these forces. And so we found quite a good fit to the biomass. And then what we did also was we could use a forecast. That could be a forecast which also goes by the data, but was not used to fit the model. And we also compared that to this is a sequential population analysis that was done in 2002, I think, to reconstruct the history of stock. And we could use a hindcast of our model and compare it to that sequence of population analysis, which we were actually very happy. It's a little bit of a lag here. So that's about the only difference that we could see. So we're really comfortable that we were finding the main drivers of the dynamics of the stock. And so then the question is, how the fishery affects farmers, what's the former. And so we look at how fishery affects product. So the energy that comes from food, it goes for the growth, the power needed, and it's stored. And then used for either reproduction or young fish, like cod, can forego reproduction. The conditions of human survival in individuals, and it's a trade-off between those two things. But when we also looked at the proportion taken, fixed volume, the human survival in individuals of the offshore stock, they found very, very small proportions. So I mean, they were not doing this energy concern, but they were not using this strategy. And so we looked at the market condition. And so, the theory is here, if you take one of those curves, flip it sideways, it's a frequency estimation of this market condition of the fish oil pump in every 6 months. So if one of those curves per year, starting in 2009, going to 2008, the blue line is a median fill condition, and these two are benchmark. And there were, I believe, some recent experiments where they found that if you are above a threshold, the green line there, the central maximum condition, and if they're below a threshold, there would be a fat condition, so that would be more. And so you can see, first of these are not there's always been an excellent condition and some fishing with a poor condition. But there's a step change around 1991 where the medium drops down and it continues down. And it, but it also, the variability is lower, so the curves are compressed this way. That means there is less buffer, less buffer space, yes? And that the proportion of fish that are out here is much, much higher than that when they started. Right? So it means that there's not more deep in South America. That's the explanation of the plot. When we looked at this, we have the graphical budget here. That's the area of the south and the renovated. This is the north. This is the south. The pattern I just showed you was for the north, where the patterns were stronger. If that pattern is there, but not as strong in detail, and we didn't say it was in the south. Biggest spawning component of the south occurred in the north in the past. And also, this coincides with a shift in the one in the north and one in the south, nothing collapsed. One in the north is here. It just came in the south. So this one starts with that story. And so from this interaction, I'll tell you that this one doesn't have a lot of relevance in the next part. I can't even see teeth. So we started to look at what parts of the land is taken. So what we started by looking at the energetic body mix. So what I'm showing you here is the somatic effect content, so think of it as energy reserves throughout the year. So people start building the reserves during the fall, then there's another winter period. Dramatically decreased in the spring, and here and now, just by this. And then, so they during the fourth spring, you build up the tree. During the other winter, you stop feeding, and they're very, almost dormant state. Then during the winter, they start feeding again, and they start feeding up in the ground. So those reserves, they move to the ground. That's why they decrease. And then just by the spawning, they stop feeding. And these are very solid fish, and most fish now spawn at 2, fish spawn at 2 or 4. And most of the fish that spawn will die. And not quite the salmon, not all of them die, but a big proportion of them die. And so what this does is, this is a very vulnerable state in the spring. And so we start looking at what happens during that time of the year. The spring, of course, spring bloom. Right? And we know from previous work, from colleagues at BIO, that the timing of when the spring bloom happens is dictated by when the sea ice retreats from the system. The sea has a lot of, the system has a lot of influence on the optic. So the system of sea ice, during the winter, the sea ice starts building in Navarro, it starts going south. what occurred, and gets back to you. Around the same time, telemetry much better to the point. Emerges from normal feet, which the main things were taken. And so after those years over winter, I guess, and in the spring at some point, they emerge and go to the surface. And so they have a long track on which they depend for survival, but that community depends on. In fact, after a few days, we will find a food source, we start to hang on to. And so that leads to a narrow food source for thinking, of course. And so what we found is, let's just focus on this part, is if the timing of these sea ice, what is, depending on the stadium on size with the timing of the salt plankton emergence, that leads to a big food source for taking and getting rid of the ice and make it to the stomach. If the sea ice is too early, then the stadium that the stadium happens, it recedes in the salt plankton emergence, you have nothing to do with each other. And that leads to a very poor food base and to other mortality. And so this is what we did. And so what I'm trying to hear is depending on the food of sea ice, there's a biomass of taken. And so this is the, it's called the normal canyon of sea ice. So it's going to happen normally. There's a match, and it will happen. If the ice recruits too early, then that leads to a low taken minus. So how do we translate this into standard advice for this important species? I don't know if I can see it, but I will. So for caping, we built a model that's able to forecast the biomass. And so we can provide science advice based on that model. So what we did was we incorporated into the model the dynamic of the CI. It's from what the writers pointed before. This is the overwintering condition, the condition in the fall when they're building up themselves. And also, because this affects the adult component of the stock, that we cannot, as someone told me in a meeting, we cannot produce this for us. We included a method of larval production 2 years prior. So what we did with this is we incorporated these three drivers and created, so this is the fit for the model. And the shaded part is the output for the projection. And with this model, we were able to produce that conventional two management cycles from advance. So we produced the advance in the spring. The typically happens in the summer. So we provide advance for that summer and for the following summer. Saying what are the, what do we expect to happen? Is it going to be really low? We cannot provide a simple answer for the next summer, but a pretty good idea. And for a fit that looks 2 years, that's another problem. Now, for Thomas, the management advice, the science advice to Bob, is for you to listen. It's a quite complex state space model. It incorporates a lot of information coming from very different sources. It incorporates uncertainty from all different sources. And it also provides uncertainty in the output. So, in that sense, it's a great tool. It's in the species. It's built on one great feature. I have is that it provides So in the doctor system, projects there, what was the self-evaluation of the physical evaluation? They looked at several potential sources, perhaps this one here. I'm not going to show you everything, I'm just going to show you the one that actually explains it, which was the salvation from the lack of prayer. So in blue, sorry, this is here, and in blue, it's the average mortality rate of the time. And in green, it's what they call starvation index, which is related to the proportion of fish that have no social condition. And as you can see, the correlation is actually remarkable. So that's saying that forces that are driving the mortality from the bottom up. It has to do with food. And so they looked also at the same mortality rate and how it relates to the amount of treatment per capita cost. So was this starvation brought by lack of treatment or something else? And again, the correlations are quite good, not as good as the one of starvation index. Is a big part of that scene. And so, my colleagues there have been working quite a bit to be trying to help to incorporate this mechanism into the space model, into the whole time. And also, what happens is the meaning for taping. The problem that students is doing that a bit later. So we have to request this from the taking meeting, and we provide self about the car, we take into consideration what we discuss in the spring for the taking meeting. Because the vehicle management requires projections of the stock, what would the stock do in 2 years or 3 years or 5 years. And so we've been working to get the outputs from our thinking model to try to guide those projections. That is a work in progress, but it's progressing faster than I expected. And now, lastly, we come to hard skills. Hard skills. The name is literally the ice level. And we need the ice for giving birth and nursing the young, for resting and for molting. Particularly for birthing, it's important to understand that this shoots up and into the mark, and it's staying with it up for about 12 days. We have a thing left in the ice. Eventually, you're able to spend, but it takes some time. The ice in the system has been getting poorer and poorer. It's got to change, of course. And so, what that, the other provides a thin platform on which you can stay when it comes to water. If that platform becomes thinner, weaker, it gets moved around and in. Over in the back in the water, and the back in the water is a big part. And there were, I think, at least 2 years when they saw extreme mortality spikes. It was a very, we had very poor ice, and they were very strong units. So, a lot of Bible based on an expected mission model and incorporated into a benefit of his mission. And he also had very important pregnancy rates. And I get the model in interviews of same pregnancy rates. That didn't make for enough of the type of pain for those couples pregnancy rates to vary over time. And so that's one of the things that we did a few years ago. We looked at what causes those pregnancies to change. And so we find what we're doing here is time, we had Texas, the pregnancy rates in the US, the dots of the internet. I told you that the population of women was very high in the 80s and 90s. And so that women, as we model the pregnancy rates, as functions of the population size. So that's an independent effect. Which captured the general downward trend, but it didn't capture all the points. It was a lot of growth. What we noticed is somewhere during the 80s, we started seeing early puppets. That means we either saw pups in the eyes that were, you know, too early for them to be there, so they wouldn't make it. So the females have the ability to carry the pregnancy towards the last trimester. That they are there, that they gave birth early, and the doctors have started already. That's the most important component of the entire cycle is actually the national level. So, prior to the medical check, prior to the national level, they drop it. And so, we start to see either drop box or by the time it was happening, it was too early for me. It should have been given them. And so when we incorporated those abortion rates into the model, we found that we could explain a lot of the ones in the field. And so what we asked, what's causing the abortion? So this is time and this abortion rate. And we found that we could explain amount of variability in the model that includes taking abundance, taking some sort of important things for questions, and the life coverage in general. We think of that not as a habitat per se, but also as a proxy for ecosystem processes. For example, we also found that the eyes affect the dynamics of. So we've been working on incorporating this into the advice. And the way we look at this is we have no separation rate, so we don't need, and we will continue to have it. So we don't need to have the output of a model or actually population model because we actually have the information. But what happens is that the hatches are assessed every 4 to 5 years, which is typical for mama. So every 4 to 5 years, an advice is produced of, say, we can take 300,000 steers annually for the next 4 or 5 years. But if in those 4 or 5 years, the pregnancy rates happen to decline, second century behind us is here in Texas. So the overview. If those who face the giants prosecute, there will be, there won't be $300,000 in harvest, or $300,000 will be too much to us. So what we're working on is using what we know about taping and how we can extend the countries of taping into incorporating that output into the protections for the ideas of the future. We're going into a big challenge where we're going to use a protection of 2 years of people and we have 40 or 5 years of that before. Perhaps it's so long. So, looking at these important components, how we vary it? Can we actually imagine the ecosystem and the ecosystem as well? We're not, and we have made considerable progress. We're moving towards it. So, we wanted to share some lessons that we learned in this long process. It's very hard to provide advice in an ecosystem as a whole. It's almost unimaginable to do that. And so what we did to adapt the problem was to start with important components of the system. And these were ones we chose. There's a lot more work being done with different components. We didn't show it, just to show you this. These are the four components we looked at. This is where the scientific progress is important. We need to describe what things are important components. So we describe all of these links from CI to the blue to sulfans, sulfans to caping, by caping to the birdlets. We feel, we fish, and actually seabirds, and I'll show here, before having managed. Seabirds that we've done quite a bit of work with colleagues from universities and environmental countries that are the links between people and seabirds. And so this is where the biggest work for scientists, understanding the workflow of the human brain, is to understand all the key relationships between the components. And then the next step is mostly government scientists. The university can have a role here, but it's mostly driven by government scientists. So we understand these relationships, but then we have to incorporate them somehow, integrate them into tools that can be used for providing these types of us. And so this can be, we can have a deterministic mode understanding one of those links, and then that link can be used into either it can be a statistical model, but it can also be statistical models that are very common. But important bit is understanding what each component, how each component affects the other, and then those relationships can be modeled in some ways. And we can use the variables themselves, so you can take it for example. Or the effect of those variables, the practice for those variables. So, for example, we know that what affects taping is the abundance of solvent. But the abundance, the potential for solvent is somewhat limited, very noisy. And so, instead of using solvent, we use tandem particles of CS, which are acid proxies for that. This is an iterative process. That's kind of a good thing. We understand something, we try to take the sound back further. That creates three more questions. We go back. So it's always back and forth. It's the other aspect of it. And the reasons are key. No one can do this on themselves. very large teams of a lot of people work on these components, and then large teams also work on integrating them. No one can do this on their own, and it can involve a large coordinator. People that I have worked with have covered in years to come up with the work that I showed here. I mean, like, I guess I should have in the beginning. But from this point of the team, just